Hello, I'm Nick Clark. This is Counting the Cost on Al Jazeera, your look at the world of business and economics. And this week, hypersonic missiles. Can the world avert a new arms race? Russia takes a lead in the new technology that can evade conventional defenses and can fly at 20 times the speed of sound. Also this week, Rwandan forces help clear up Mozambique's militant insurgency. Will oil giants and migrant workers return to the gas-rich fields in the north of the country? And we're in Tuscany, home to Italy's cultural heartland, but has also become a target of organized crime, and they're leaving behind a toxic legacy. So President Vladimir Putin dubbed it the invincible, and with good reason. Russia's new hypersonic missile can travel at 7 times the speed of sound and can hit a target before existing missile systems have time to react. Its technology is world-beating, with the United States months away from a comparable missile. The target of the missile is NATO aircraft carriers, and if a nuclear warhead is attached, it would only require one missile to knock out the carrier. A week or so later, earlier this month, Putin inspected a prototype lightweight stealth fighter plane. The only plane comparable to Checkmate, as it's known, is the US-built F-35, causing more geopolitical headaches for the Pentagon. Moscow hopes to sell the single-seater radar-evading fighter to India, the United Arab Emirates, and to Vietnam. Priced at about $30 million, it's cheaper than the $120 million F-35 and could open up new markets. Arms sales are a key part of Moscow's push to increase its geopolitical clout from the Middle East to Africa. Russia is no longer a superpower, having ceded any pretense to that claim with the collapse of the Soviet Union. It lacks the global reach of the United States, but is still ranked as the world's number two military power. And for good reason, it continues to be a major concern to Western powers and close European neighbours. It's demonstrated its ability to project force abroad with its deployment of forces to Syria. And where it can't directly send troops, Moscow still managed to reshape battlefields through mercenaries in the Ukraine, Libya and Central African Republic. While Russia's military expenditure increased by 2.5% in 2020 to reach almost $62 billion, putting it behind India, China and the United States. That's according to the Stockholm International Peace Research Institute. Russia is the second biggest exporter of conventional weapons with 20% of the market. The United States maintains its lead with 37%. And despite the pandemic, military sales held up. According to the Moscow Times, its order book remained at a level of $50 to $55 billion in 2020. In 2019 and 2018, Russia received orders for its weapons worth $51 billion and $55 billion, respectively. All right, let's get some analysis with Dmitry Stefanovich. Joins me now from Moscow via Skype. Dmitry Stefanovich, welcome to Counting the Cost. So first up, the technical challenge with hypersonic weapons is enormous, isn't it? How has Russia managed to get ahead of the game here?
In Russian case, we've invested a lot, or even during the harshest years of the 90s and 2000s, in strategic weapons, and now it paid off. While in other countries, probably there were not the investments were not as stable as in Russian case. Another important factor is that, well, we must understand that hypersonic weapons are not that new. Actual research dates decades ago. So probably now what we get, what we've got during the last decades, last years, is that we actually achieved reliable systems due to materials, due to hardened electronics, due to communications and things like that.
Why is Russia developing this technology?
The reason for rapid investments in the 2000s is actually U.S. withdrawal from the ABM treaty, the treaty that limited missile defenses. And hypersonic weapons are considered as a good tool to overcome any foreseeable missile defenses or take out missile defense assets on a tactical scale. Another reason why probably there was some speed up and deployment of not yet well-developed systems is the general deterioration of military political situation. Because despite all the claims of like Russian aggression and crazy things like that, the actual reason for that is the Russian sense of vulnerability, Russian sense of military inferiority to the capabilities of the US and probably some other states.
It's very evident these are dangerous weapons. What needs to be done to ensure there isn't any proliferation in this technology?
I'm afraid that if we speak about proliferation as in development of these weapons in other countries or selling those, the only tool to do is to strengthen the existing export control regimes, like the missile technology control regime and probably some other instruments. And I might remind everyone that Russia will be ahead of the MTCR, of the missile technology control regime, the next head in 2021-2022. And I'm looking forward to see some initiatives that might address hypersonic weapons as well. On the other hand, it is impossible to limit the national developments in this field. And probably if the country, if this or that country will believe that these type of weapons are necessary to achieve, to ensure their security.
But what about this Checkmate fighter that we were just talking about? That is a real door opener to markets, isn't it?
The Checkmate fighter is developed to actually help third countries enhance their security. And also enhance it relatively cheap without wasting too much resources. At least this is the idea. It remains to be seen whether the Checkmate will actually fly, both in terms of flying as an airplane and flying as a project. But I believe that there are reasons for some cautious optimism. Because, well, definitely there is no comparable offer on the market at all, because we have the F-35 single engine fifth generation jet, but it is expensive, and as any US weaponry, it comes with a set of political obligations and things like that.
And hypersonic weapons or fighter jets, the arms trade overall for Russia is very important, and more so indeed than its oil and agricultural exports.
If we speak about weapons, the export contracts also contribute to the well-being of the Russian military industry, because obviously you can sell weapons abroad for greater prices than you need to sell them to the national armed forces.
Now, what about Afghanistan? Russia, not a superpower, but it certainly wields a great deal of influence, and the U.S. withdrawal from Afghanistan will be perceived as a great victory for a great advance for Russia, won't it?
Well, I can't agree that it is a victory or an advantage for Russia, because in the end we have another hot spot. Well, it was there for a while, but now it's getting hotter near our borders, near borders of our allies within the CSTO, the Collective Security Treaty Organization, within our partners of the SCO, the Shanghai Cooperation Organization. And it also leads to a number of possible disagreements with India, with Pakistan, with China, which are all very important for Russian international policy and actually Russian economy as well. So I wouldn't paint it as in like black and white tones, like bad for US, good for Russia. It's much more complicated. Although, of course, Russia tries to be proactive in contacts with the Afghanistan and new leadership in Afghanistan. Russia tries to keep things manageable, but it remains to be seen who will get the advantage after all this crazy situation.
Indeed. Just great to get your analysis, Dmitry Stefanovich. Thank you very much.
Thank you. It was a pleasure.
Now, investigators say one of Italy's most powerful criminal organizations has been dumping thousands of tons of toxic waste, and it's allegedly being left in one of the country's most scenic regions. From Tuscany, here's Adam Rainey.
On the edge of a farm in Tuscany, environmental police check for toxic runoff from a leather tannery water treatment plant. It looks clear now. But this officer says until recently, this plant was releasing waste into the river. The commander shows us footage of the same river. He says it shows how the 'Ndrangheta, one of Italy's most powerful criminal organizations, allegedly dumped tons of toxic waste from leather plants. And he showed us how they allegedly buried toxic mud under highways across Tuscany, a wealthy area of Italy considered far removed from historic mafia strongholds in the south.
It's a complex investigation going on 3 years now. We've charged people with various crimes for taking part in a criminal conspiracy. That's aggravated by dealing with the mafia, trafficking waste, and polluting the environment.
Police say suspects pocketed tens of millions of euros to clean up the byproducts of Italy's leather industry, byproducts that include heavy metals that can cause cancer. We drove by the tanneries with Mario Risaliti, who worked in the leather plants for more than 45 years.
Pollution has always been common. The problem is the mud and ash. The byproduct from the tannery should be treated and made harmless to use as landfill, but they didn't do that.
I asked Mario if all this pollution was an open secret here.
Pollution and cancer have always been considered a necessary evil, but that's the job. The tanneries sit at the top of the food pyramid.
It's highways like this one that cut across a landscape of wineries and small farms where the waste was buried.
We're here along an embankment where investigators found toxic waste buried under the highway. They took soil samples, then covered it back up with this tarp. Police say they've found 10 such sites across Tuscany, but they acknowledge there may be dozens of others across the region.
We met with citizens groups who are pushing local officials to give them answers.
We have 8,000 tons of dangerous material. We don't know exactly what it is made of, and it's exactly there. So we are really very scared.
Mafia expert Renato Scalia has repeatedly warned Tuscan authorities.
For years, we've been raising the alarm that the mafia is here in Tuscany, but it falls on deaf ears. The conventional wisdom says we shouldn't raise the issue because it's seen as smearing Tuscany's honor and reputation.
A reputation, and more importantly, an environment now in need of being cleaned up.
Well, earlier this month, a force including Rwandan troops captured the port of Mokumbura de Praia from Islamist insurgents. It could be a turning point in the four-year insurgency, which has crippled Mozambique's gas-rich north as foreign companies evacuated their staff. Over that time, thousands of people have been killed and hundreds of thousands have been displaced. Catherine Soy has this report.
These are soldiers from Mozambique and Rwanda in the port city of Mozambique da Praia. The region in northern Mozambique's Cabo Delgado province was the last stronghold of an armed group locally known as Al-Shabaab. The fighters had used it to launch attacks across the province since 2017. More than 2,000 people have been killed and hundreds of thousands displaced. The soldiers here are upbeat. Their commanders say it will now take less than a month to complete the offensive in the entire province.
The enemy harbor was this Mozambique da Praia. And as you have seen along the way, most of the enemy are killed, were killed along the way. So others have disappeared in the forest. We are now planning to pursue those few enemy pockets along Mbao axis.
Mozambique has been struggling to fight against the armed group, which is believed to have ties with ISIL. The town of Palma, 80 kilometers away, is a scene of the most recent major attack. Fighters laid siege for days in March, killing several people and causing many to flee from their homes. It was one of several attacks that was planned from Mozambique da Praia, so the town falling back into the hands of government forces is a strategic victory. Rwanda deployed its troops in July to help Mozambique's national army.
The enemy was estimated to be between 2,000 and 3,000. Uh-huh. But it was deployed in small groups. Concerning the importance of the ground, it is very important because it is the headquarters of the terrorists.
Many people are still afraid to go home and continue to live rough in camps for the displaced.
We did not cause the conflict. We are suffering losses without knowing the cause. We are just ordinary citizens.
Mozambicans in this region, rich in oil, gas and other minerals, say they want peace. They want to rebuild their towns, and they hope the troops will keep them safe enough to go back home.
Well, what little is known about the rise of the Islamist insurgency has been attributed to inequality and the lack of jobs in a region which is expected to deliver $100 billion in gas revenue in the coming decades. Ironically, the insurgency started after a $2 billion loan scandal came to light in 2016. For one of the poorest countries, that represents 12% of GDP. And according to Independent Development Institute, CMI, the scandal may have cost the country at least $11 billion, nearly the country's entire 2016 GDP. It's estimated that almost 2 million people have been pushed into poverty. The off-budget military spending involved companies that were partly owned by Mozambique security forces. $500 million was to be spent on patrol aircraft, boats and radars. $200 million was to pay middlemen. $1.3 billion has still not been accounted for. And that's the starting point of our analysis with Jasmine Opperman. Jasmine is an Africa analyst at North 14 Strategies, a Senegal-based think tank, joins us now from Pretoria. Jasmine Opperman, first up, has anyone been held to account for this missing money?
No one has been held to account. And I don't think we must expect that it will be quite soon already. It seems like the extradition order is on hold. We must keep in mind there are high-profile people linked to this case.
So there is this question mark over what will happen next with those that have been arrested and whether indeed he will face justice?
A good question. I mean, all eyes are now on the Mozambican judicial system. And I think that's where the problem lies, both from South Africa and the United States, is how fair a trial it will be when it comes to these people being involved, and will they be used as a diversion from those that actually benefited from a massive amount of money that started the downward spiral for Mozambicans' financial position. I do not think at the end of the day we are going to truly see that there will be a conclusive judgment and prosecution and incarceration of those that benefited, just like we have seen for the past how many years in Mozambique with organized crime.
It is Mozambique's former finance minister who's in the frame. And the concern, as you say, is that he could get off lightly compared to what might happen if he was, say, extradited to the United States, where investors were conned out of millions of dollars.
Yes, correctly. And I think that is why, and I think the whole issue of the United States comes down to diplomatic relations between South Africa and the United States, between Mozambique and the United States. And then also United States and those names being mentioned and companies involved, how much exposure do they actually want in terms of the benefits that obviously would have gone to specific individuals?
And as far as the ongoing violence is concerned, Mozambique, of course, part of SADC, the Southern African Development Community, yet the president was slow to get military support from some of his staunchest allies, like Zimbabwe and South Africa. Why was that?
I do believe that we need to realize there's a war economy at play. We need to understand that there are contracts with vast amounts of money at play. We need to understand that Cabo Delgado has a historical context of officials gaining from organized crime syndicates. So by involving SADC, by getting control, it has to be accompanied by accountability. How much is the government willing to accept responsibility for what they have contributed to the forgotten Cabo Delgado? And I do not see a shift in that mindset. I do see a shift that development is needed, that they need to look at certain crucial aspects in terms of bringing people back to their land. But in terms of accepting responsibility and accountability, we're seeing a government in Maputo still reluctant in putting the cards on the table.
You mentioned Rwanda. What do they get from this?
I think one must start off by saying that they've made a difference, yes. But they've made a difference on what I call the low-hanging fruits. That is to say, the areas we expected them to move in. But if you look at their deployments, it's all Palma, Mosambua de Praia, although Nangadi can be added now with the Tanzanian border. But clearly the LNG sector and the security corridor gains paramount importance. Hence, we're going back to France. And we're going back to that France, more than likely, is contributing excessively to their financial deployment in Cabo Delgado with the intent to get the LNG sector Total with a 26% interest in this, going as quickly as possible, and with that, expanding French interest. And that is an undeniable reality. Secondly, a crucial aspect is how this plays into the audience in Rwanda. They've immediately had journalists accompany them, immediately there were reports on the successes they have gained, excessive numbers to start off with. I see they're downplaying the numbers now. But there's also a message back home of a defense force in control, capable of dealing with the situation, and with that, bolstering the position of President Kagame.
And it's interesting you mentioned France, isn't it? Because for comparison, we can look at France's counterinsurgency efforts in the Sahel, which actually haven't worked. And you could say that violence has increased. Well, it has.
Yes, if you look at Sahel and they're trying to withdraw and it is not as easy. And if you look at Afghanistan, just to throw that into this whirlpool of political agendas and interests. But if you look in terms of stepping into Sahel was quite easy, stepping out is not that easy. So for France to making use of Rwanda, and I hate the word proxy as it has connotations, but let's use the word proxy for the lack of a better word, without any direct involvement, gives them that leverage of behind the scenes pressure, influence, and leverage over the Mozambican government, which still prioritize the LNG sector as an important economic development, which it is, but not the way it was done the last 3-4 years.
Jasmine Opperman, appreciate that. Thank you.
It's a pleasure.
Now, two high-profile sexual assault cases have brought China's Me Too movement back into the spotlight. Chinese-Canadian pop star Chris Wu is under investigation after being accused of rape. It follows an outcry over an alleged assault at the tech giant Alibaba. Katrina Yu reports now from Beijing.
A video of a woman protesting in her workplace canteen was viewed hundreds of millions of times on Chinese social media. The employee of tech giant Alibaba had been silenced after accusing her boss of raping her during a business trip last month. Security cameras recorded her supervisor entering her hotel room several times. The woman took to social media after management failed to act.
The Alibaba human resources team were slow and indifferent. They didn't take it seriously. I was shocked because Alibaba is such a big, famous company, but I'm also used to it because these incidents happen again and again.
Public outrage around the case prompted a police investigation. Alibaba fired the man in question and also several executives for mishandling her complaint. The incident came the week after the arrest of Chinese-Canadian celebrity Chris Wu. The pop singer, actor and variety show judge has been accused of luring underage women for sex. More than a dozen brands, including Louis Vuitton and Porsche, have severed ties with Wu, and there have been calls for him to be deported.
Both incidents have turned the spotlight on cases of sexual assault and misconduct in Chinese workplaces. It's also given a boost to the country's Me Too movement, which has been stifled by authorities in recent years due to concerns of sparking social unrest.
Li Maizi is a women's rights activist who was detained in 2015 for protesting about sexual harassment on public transport. She says women working for Chinese companies often suffer harassment and are forced to drink during business events.
Alibaba has a serious problem. I would say there's a culture of hunting women or using women as sexual resources. This phenomenon also exists in many other big companies, state enterprises, and even NGOs.
In recent years, China has introduced laws dealing with domestic violence and sexual misconduct, but activists say they're poorly defined and difficult to enforce. Police are often reluctant to interfere with what are traditionally seen as private matters. Alibaba says it's reviewing company guidelines and has set up an emergency hotline for employees. Rights groups say they hope the Alibaba and Chris Wu scandals will encourage more victims to come forward and for employers to change their work cultures.
And that is our show for this week. If you'd like to comment on anything you've seen, you can tweet me at Nick Clark Al Jazz. Please use the hashtag AJC2C or drop us an email. Counterthecost@aljazeera.net is our address. There's plenty more online at aljazeera.com/CDC. That will take you straight to our page, which has entire episodes for you to catch up on. But that's it for this edition of Counter the Cost. I'm Nick Clark from the whole team. Thanks for joining us. The news on Al Jazeera is next.